Hello, mighty companion. This is Earl Rise Purdy, and I'm here today to do Course in Miracles Lesson 186. I'm going to read it to you with a lot of feeling and a lot of devotion and a lot of passion. And it's called Salvation of the World Depends on Me. And one of the definitions of salvation is forgiveness and right-mindedness. So the forgiveness and right-mindedness and healing of the world depends on me. Now, don't freak out because it looks like you got a lot of responsibility there. I want you to hear it. Salvation of the world depends on me. Forgiveness of the world, healing of the world depends on me. Here's the statement that will one day take all arrogance away from your mind and everybody else's mind. That the right-mindedness of the world depends on you is really the thought of true humility, which holds no function as your function but that which was given you. You're going to hold no function as your own but that function that has been given you by God. So right-mindedness, which is salvation, it's another word for right-mindedness or healing. The healing... The right-mindedness of the world, your function, it offers you acceptance of a part assigned to you without insisting on another role. It doesn't judge your proper role, but acknowledges the will of God is done on earth as it is in heaven, which is reality. Today's lesson unites all wills on earth in the truth plan, heaven's plan, to save the world, restoring it to heaven's peace. Let us not fight our function. We didn't establish our function. It's not our idea. The means are given us by which our function would be perfectly accomplished. All that we are asked to do is to accept our part in genuine humility. That means we are asked not to deny with self-deceiving arrogance that we are worthy. What's given us to do, we have the strength to do. Our minds are suited perfectly to take the part assigned to us by God, who knows us well. Today's idea, salvation of the world depends on you, may seem quite sobering until you see its meaning. All the lesson for today is saying is that your Creator still remembers you and offers you the perfect trust your Creator holds in you, who are your Creator's creation. Today's lesson doesn't ask that you be different in any way from the way you are. What could humility request but that you not be anything other than yourself? And what could arrogance deny but your ability to be yourself? So today, we will not shrink from our assignment on the specious grounds that modesty is outraged. It is pride that would deny God's call. All false humility we're going to lay aside today so that we can listen to God's voice, because God's voice is going to reveal to us what God's voice wants us to do. We don't doubt our adequacy for the functional role that God has offered us. We will be certain only that God really knows our strengths and our wisdom and our holiness and our innocence, which is what holiness is. And if God deems us as worthy to do this function, then we're worthy to do this function. It's but arrogance that says that you are not powerful enough to fulfill the function that God has given you. There is one way and only one way to be released from the imprisonment your plan to prove the false is true has brought to you. Accept the plan of God's, which is a plan you didn't make instead. Don't judge your value to God's plan. If God's voice assures you that the plan meets your part and that the whole depends on you, be sure that that's the way it is. The arrogant must cling to words. The arrogant are afraid to go beyond words to experience which might affront their stance. Yet are the humble free. The humble are free to hear God's voice. God's voice tells the humble what they are, and God's voice tells the humble what to do. Arrogance, do you know that arrogance makes an image of yourself that's not real? It is this image of yourself that's not real that quails and retreats in terror, as the voice for God assures you that you have the strength, you have the wisdom and the innocence to go beyond all images. You aren't weak, as is the ego or the strange image of yourself. You are not ignorant and you are not helpless. Sin, the idea of sin, cannot tarnish the truth in you, and misery can't come near the holy home of God, which is who you are, by the way. All this is what God's voice is going to relate to you, and as God's voice speaks, your ego, the image you have of yourself, it trembles and seeks to attack the threat it does not know. In other words, your ego senses its basis crumble. Let your ego, let your old images of yourself go. Salvation of the world, which is the forgiveness of the world, depends on you and not upon this little pile of dust called your ego body. What can the ego body illusion that you think you are tell the real you, the holy child of God? Why need you be concerned with your ego image at all? And so we find our peace. That means we will accept the function God has given us, for all illusions, all false ideas rest upon the weird belief that we can make another wheel for ourselves. Do you know that our self-made roles are shifting, and our self-made roles seem to change from mourner? Our self-made roles are shifting, and they seem to change from mourner to ecstatic bliss of love and loving. We can laugh or cry, and we can greet the day with welcome, or we can greet the day with tears. Our very being seems to change as we experience a thousand shifts in mood, and our emotions raise us high indeed or dash us to the ground in hopelessness. Is this you, the real you? Is this the child of God? Could God create such instability and call it God's creation? He who is changeless shares his attributes with his creation. That means all the images that you appear to make really have no real effect on what you really are. All the images and ideas that you have about yourself, they just blow across your mind like windswept leaves that form a pattern in an instant, break apart to group again and scamper off. Or like mirages seen above a desert, rising from the dust. These unsubstantial images will go. That means they will leave your mind unclouded and serene when you accept the function given you. The images of fear you make give rise to but conflicting goals, impermanent and vague, uncertain and ambiguous. Who could be constant in their efforts? How could you direct your energies and concentrated drive toward illusionary goals like these? The functions which the world esteems are so uncertain that the functions that the world esteems change 10 times an hour at their most secure. You know that. What hope of gain can rest on goals like this? In lovely contrast, certain as the sun's return each morning to dispel the night, your truly given function stands out clear and totally unambiguous. There is no doubt of its validity. Your true function comes from the one who doesn't know anything about mistakes, and God's voice is certain of its messages. God's voice, God's messages will not change nor be in conflict. All of God's messages point to just one goal, and one goal that you can attain. Your plan may be impossible, but God's can never fail because God is the source of the plan. So God's plan can never fail. Do as God's voice directs. And if God's voice asks a thing of you which seems impossible, remember that it's God who's asking you, and it's you that would make denial. Then I want you to consider this. Which is more likely to be right? The voice that speaks for God, the creator of all things, who knows all things exactly as all things are, or your ego, a distorted image of yourself that's confused and bewildered, inconsistent, and unsure of every friggin' thing? Don't let the voice of your fearful self, your ego, direct you. Hear instead a certain voice from God, which tells you of a function given you by your creator, your creator remembers you and urges you now that you remember your creator. Your creator's gentle voice is calling from the known to the unknowing. Do you know that your creator's voice would comfort you, although your creator doesn't know anything about sorrow? Your creator would make restitution, though your creator is complete. And also a gift to you. Although your creator knows that you have everything already, your creator has thoughts which answer every need you perceive, although your creator doesn't see your needs. For love must give, and your creator is love. Love must give, and what is given in the name of the creator takes on the form most useful in the world of form. These are the forms which never can deceive, because these forms come from God, the formlessness itself. Forgiveness is an earthly form of love, which as it is in heaven, love has no form in reality. Yet what is needed here is given here as it's needed. In this form, you can fulfill your function even here, although what love will mean to you when formlessness has been restored to you is greater still. Salvation, which is right-mindedness, which is healing. The healing of the world depends on you, you who can forgive, who can correctly perceive, correctly perceiving, which is forgiving. Such is your function. So your lesson for today is salvation of the world depends on me. The world depends on me. Salvation of the world depends on you. That means the healing of the world depends on you. The healing of the world depends on you. That's right, mighty companion. Salvation of the world depends on you. And this is Earl Purdy. Check me out at www.earlpurdy.com and let peace extend from my mind to yours.